Repress your emotions through certain training scenarios.
That dwarf gecko, I wanna be in its place. Oh yeah. In 2009, the creator of the legendary Metal Gear franchise, Hideo Kojima, confirmed the development of a spin-off everyone wanted, Metal Gear Solid Rising, a hack and slash set in the universe of the franchise in which you get to control the ninja cyborg Raiden. And of course, everybody was hyped. We all witnessed the epic cutscenes with Gray Fox in the original Metal Gear Solid or Raiden himself in MGS4. We all wanted to finally control a ninja cyborg. Sadly, when Kojima realized the product was not coming out as he wanted to, he decided to finally cancel it. End of the story. Wait, you silly goose muffin. Of course the story didn't end there. Some years later, Kojima revealed that the project was still going on, but it was rebooted with the help of hack and slash experts, Platinum Games, creators of Bayonetta and Mad World, who made the game way faster and overall more solid, not pun intended. The final product was named Metal Gear Rising Revengeance. Is that even a real word? Silly name aside, the game was released last year, and I got it for my brand new PS3, and it's also available on Xbox 360 and PC. While some nitpicky Metal Gear fans did not realize this was a spin-off and hated it for being based on action rather than stealth, the general public loved the blood-pumping, dynamic and unique action gameplay. So, I am here today with my fifth Obsidious fan reviews to tell you my own personal opinion. Did Kojima and Platinum Games deliver, or Metal Gear Rising will be forgotten as easily as Metal Gear Acid? Spoiler alert, I think this game is fucking awesome! Sorry, let's dive into it and find out. The events in Metal Gear Rising are set 4 years after Metal Gear Solid 4, Guns of the Patriots. Are you worried that you want to understand the plot of this game, but you've never played a Metal Gear game before, especially Guns of the Patriots? Well, first of all, what's wrong with you? MGS is an amazing franchise! Go and play it right now! Secondly, don't worry, because it's not that big of a deal. When I played this game, I haven't even played MGS4, and I still could follow the plot very easily, and so will you. Granted, you will understand way more stuff if you play them, that's a given, but it's not a major requirement. Anyways, on this story, the badass cyborg ninja Raiden is back for a new adventure. He now works with a PMC as the bodyguard for political figures, especially a prime minister in Africa. And luckily for him, a group of cyborgs as powerful as him, and maybe even more, controlled by another PMC, pop out, kill the Prime Minister Raiden was supposed to protect, and beat the crap out of him. Now he has been reconstructed, and now he has to take down the evil cyborg PMC, seeking for revenge. Or revengeance. Get it? It's revenge plus vengeance! Combined wars are fun! As you can possibly tell, the plot of Metal Gear Rising is way more straightforward and simplistic than in other games in this franchise. However, it still contains some of the major familiar themes in every other Metal Gear game. Cyborgs, PMCs, morals about war and justice, child soldiers, and many more. This may even get confusing at times, and with a plotline that is not that engaging, you may even lose interest at some point. It's nothing too impressive, but it gets the job done, and it gives you a reason to keep on fighting. However, what redeems this decent storyline are the characters. Raiden is more badass than ever, and he even starts to develop when he realizes that he may not be fighting for the reasons he thought. Does he really want to protect the weak, or he's just an assassin with an excuse to kill every cyborg he encounters? All this questioning really make Raiden a likable new hero. Well, not as likable as Solid Snake, but still a great protagonist. Other characters worth mentioning include Chestrin Sam, who is kind of Raiden's rival and is responsible for all his questions, Blade Wolf, a wolf robot who is looking for freedom, and the bosses of this game, the Winds of Destruction. Sam is a pseudo-member of the Cyborg unit in their PMC, and just like Foxhound, the Cobra unit, or the Beauty and the Beast unit, they all have interesting backstories, personalities, weapons, and, obviously, some excellent boss battles. Now that I think of it, at least 90% of this roster of characters is memorable and likable. I guess we couldn't expect less from the mastermind that is Hideo Kojima. One last character I want to mention is the main villain and final boss of this game. I won't spoil it because it's something you just have to see for yourself. It's over the top, hilarious, and really freaking awesome. Why is this villain so fucking fantastic? Well, because of the
nanomachine, son.
When Revengeance was originally MGS Rising, Kojima Productions was going to use an updated version of the Fox engine, making the game look really, really good. Sadly, Platinum Games use an inferior engine that doesn't look nearly as good. But that doesn't mean the graphics are bad. Every character looks great, with a mixture of realism and cartoon style, the environments and enemies look solid, and the overall experience is a joy to look at. Well, most of the times. While I adore the character and enemy designs, the level design is really lackluster. Raiden will go through generic, extremely linear, and downright colorless environments, mostly cities devastated with war or buildings of the PMC. It really feels disappointing, especially when you visit a really tiny section of the building that simulates a classic Japanese garden. This is the only level in the game that is actually different. I really wish they did more of this. Heck, they didn't even bother in making cliché levels that Metal Gear has experienced in the past. You know, like the forest level, the desert level, the snow level, and even a water level. Okay, maybe not that one. If they ever make a sequel, they must include more colorful levels with lots of variation. While the graphics are decent and the level design is lackluster, the soundtrack is just... oh my god! Words cannot describe how fantastically epic the music in Metal Gear Rising Revengeance is. Most of this soundtrack is full of heavy rock songs with sweet instrumentation and clever lyrics, especially the boss themes, who all take a page from Margaret Moonlight, and their boss themes are actually sung by them and represent their feelings. The result? Pure musical bliss, and the atmosphere is perfect on these boss battles. Trust me when I say that you will listen to it many, many times. In fact, I am listening to it right now while I write this script. Funny, eh? The original soundtrack is one of my favorites in video game history, and it will make your blood boil and sing around like a demented metal fan. RULES OF NATURE! The voice acting is as good as in every other Metal Gear title. My man Quinton Flynn returns as the voice of Raiden, and he has definitely improved in some of the most awkward dialogue from Sons of Liberty.
We've managed to avoid drowning. Good job.
Yeah. The rest of the voice actors also do an amazing job in all of their roles, especially with the well-written dialogue of this game, with tons of memorable quotes, with my favorite being this one.
Like I said, kids are cruel, Jack. And I'm very in touch with my inner child.
The combat system of Metal Gear Rising Revengeance is both familiar and unique at the same time. If you played games like Devil May Cry before, you will be right at home with this one. But that doesn't mean there is no innovation in the combat. The control is simple but effective, you know, one button to jump, another one to run, one button for light attack, another one for heavy attack, a button to perform actions, and etc. Overall, you really feel like you are controlling a badass cyborg ninja. However, I have three minor complaints about the control. First of all, the lock-on system is pretty much non-existent. Secondly, Raiden's jumping is incredibly stiff and unnecessary. In fact, it's only there to perform some aerial combos, since you can avoid obstacles by holding down the Ninja Ram button. Lastly, the parrying slash blocking system could use some work as well, and it takes its time to get used to. Aside from that, the smooth control allows an amazing and satisfying combat system that gets deeper as you get deeper in the game, and you will do your basic stuff from action games, like unlocking weapons, costumes and a lot of sweet combos. The action of Metal Gear Rising is very similar to Devil May Cry, and I mean that it's a stylish, badass, full of adrenaline, and it will make you scream out loud,
"This is the best game ever!"
So far, the combat system of Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, while incredibly entertaining, doesn't seem quite innovative, right? Oh, that's where you would be wrong, my friend. What sets Metal Gear Rising apart from other hack and slash games is the inclusion of Blade Mode. It's really simple. You keep pressing one button and, if Raiden has enough energy, he will be able to slow time for a while and completely slash through his enemies as if they were a piece of butter. This is how a sword in a game should always feel! This gameplay mechanic works wonders for this game, and I would love to see more of it in a future sequel. However, if you think Blade Mode can be broken for the difficulty, don't worry, since most of the times you will have to attack an enemy enough to break its defenses before you can slash through it, so it has its balance. Another great addition to Blade Mode is Sandatsu. What is that? Well, Sandatsu is a secret ninja technique that Raiden can use in order to slash right through the middle of an enemy to take out his cyborg intestines in order to fill his energy and life. While this mechanic can be easily exploited in the easiest difficulty settings, it comes as really handy in the hardest ones, and it's just very, very cool. Why even question it? The main thing that you will do in every level is slashing through tons of enemies. Overall, it's extremely entertaining and fun, and you will love every minute about it. However, is there something different to doing this game? Well, there is one thing that keeps Metal Gear Rising away from being repetitive or stale. It gives you the freedom to decide what to do on each screen. When you encounter a bunch of enemies, they won't notice you immediately. Like every other Metal Gear game, you can actually sneak around the place and kill your enemies with some sweet ninja stealth executions. Granted, the stealth mechanic is nowhere as near as deep or engaging as other Metal Gear games, but still, it's great to have the freedom to choose what to do. Aside from that, every time you are not killing enemies, this game is rather disappointing. It's full of script action scenes where it's almost impossible to die, and other really short sections with variety. As expected, these do not add anything to the gameplay, and they are just there as eye candy. One part of the game that stuck in my mind particularly is when Raiden actually hijacks a Scarab and controls it in order to get into the next room. This only happens once in the entire game, and I would have loved to see this as a major gameplay mechanic in order to get more variety, especially if we were able to do it with other AI enemies, like Geckos or Mastiffs. Keep this in mind for a future sequel, Platinum Games! So far, the main combat in this game is near perfect for me, but I do have issues with the sub-weapons. That's right, Raiden can pick up different objects and weapons to use through his adventure. While some of them can get some use, like stunning grenades or cardboard boxes, the damaging weapons, like missile launchers, are kind of pointless if you think about it. Heck, you can spend the entire game without using a single sub-weapon. Metal Gear Rising didn't find a proper use for them. Personally, I would have loved to see Raiden use some kind of cyborg ninja shuriken or bow in a dynamic and badass way. Like I said many times during this review already, I hope we see more of that in a future sequel. But enough talk about pointless flaws. Let's talk about possibly the strongest point in Metal Gear Rising: the boss battles. If you know me well, I love boss battles. Okay, maybe a bit too much, but still, Metal Gear Rising Revengeance has some of my favorite battles in the entire Metal Gear franchise. Most bosses are full of personality and charm to them. They all have multiple faces, incredible music, and overall just plain entertaining gameplay that makes you feel full of adrenaline. And like Mega Man, Raiden can get their weapon of choice to use after he defeats each boss, which will replace the heavy attack. That is a clever and fun idea. Some of my favorites include Sundowner, Jetstream Sam, and the final boss. Heck, I can even get enjoyment out of my least favorite boss in the game, Monsoon. That is impressive, and it's worth playing this game just for the bosses. They are that good. However, there is one particular section of this game that really bugs me. I hate when a game rehashes all the bosses right at the end. Capcom often does this, and it's just a shallow form of a stupid filler. Metal Gear Rising Revengeance is also guilty of this, but it's even worse. They rehash only two bosses of the game, as you still didn't encounter the others, their musical themes are downgraded, and they are consisted of just one mindless face. This part of the game was really unnecessary, and it kept me wondering.
What the fuck were they thinking?
But I want to address that this game has a major flaw. It's short. Not as short as, said, Crash to Insanity, but it will really keep you wanting for more once you beat it. Luckily for you, this game is a completionist's wet dream, as there is a lot of stuff to look for on each level, in order to unlock new things like weapons or costumes. Cutting off the left arms of cyborgs, finding hidden items, and even VR missions that can give you tons of replay value, especially since these missions actually get a lot of gameplay variety. So don't worry, as you will spend a lot of time playing Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, and you will feel like your money was worth it. I mean, Hideo Kojima and Konami will always deliver on that area, right? They would never make a really short game that you can beat in less than an hour, right? Oh no, oh please take that thing off my video! Finally, before we move on to the final section, I just have to praise the extra DLCs for this game, in which you actually get to play as Blade Wolf and Restream Sam. Their gameplay is unique, and in the case of Sam, I actually prefer to play as him over Raiden. They have new and awesome bosses, and it actually expands the plot of the game. And the best thing, these DLCs are free right now, so there is no excuse for you to not download them! Let me be unprofessional for a second, so I can say, I freaking love this game! Metal Gear Rising Revengeance is one of my favorite hack and slash games, right there with Devil May Cry 3 and No More Heroes 1 and 2. There is just so much to love about this amazing spin-off! Trust me when I say that everyone who played this game fell in love with it. Despite being an action spin-off from a stealth video game franchise, Metal Gear Rising Revengeance truly deserves to have the Metal Gear name on its title. With engaging dialogue and characters, and downright immersive and dynamic gameplay, we all hope Metal Gear Rising becomes its own spin-off franchise, like Mario Kart or Persona. Like you would expect from a solid hack and slash, the combat, the weapons, the boss battles, and even most of the story are near perfection, especially with the inclusion of unique mechanics like Blade Mode and Sandatsu. If you're looking for a dynamic action game, look no further. Okay, yeah, Metal Gear Rising has some flaws, but all of them are really specific and nothing that will take you out of the experience. Linear levels, useless sub-weapons, the over-the-top story may turn off some hardcore Metal Gear fans. Indeed, there is a lot to polish here. Overall, Metal Gear Rising Revengeance gets my personal score of an 8 out of 10, and I'm going to label it as sequel material. Yeah, I did mention a possible sequel many times during this video, didn't I? Hey, don't blame me! It's just that this game really has a lot of potential, and all of its flaws can be easily fixed in a future installment. This game really reached a soft spot in the hearts of many people, including myself, so I am confident that you will love it as much as everybody else. I am Obsidious fan, and this review has come to an end. So tell me, what do you think about this game? What do you think about my review? Which other games would you like to see me review in the future? Just leave a comment down below. Thanks a lot for watching, see you guys next time!